Instead of using two-phase locking, we can also use timestamp-based approaches to achieve conflict-serializable schedules. So let's see how this works. Assuming we have a transaction TI coming into the system, and at arrival, this transaction gets assigned a timestamp, let's say 10. And also, there's a new transaction coming in later. We call that TJ here. And this also gets a timestamp, which is larger than the previous ones, say 15. So the idea behind timestamp-based scheduling is that we have, let's say, a variable or some data object X in a database. And when there is a transaction accessing this X, reading or writing it, it will leave the timestamp of the transaction with X. So we remember this in our schedule. So let's say TI is reading X, so we would have a 10 here. And later on, TJ would like to read as well, or to write X, and would compare then this 15 to 10. And the idea here in timestamp-based scheduling is that if you have conflicting operations like a write-write or a read-write or a write-read, then this is only possible if the timestamp, which is already assigned to X, is strictly smaller than the timestamp of the transaction that now wants to do a conflict operation on X. So again, we have a timestamp. We call that TS of TI for every transaction TI. And now, more formally, what I just said is called the central rule of timestamp ordering. If you have P and Q being conflict operations, for instance, read-write, and P comes from transaction I, and Q comes from transaction J, then for every schedule S, it has to hold that if P comes before Q in the schedule S, then the timestamp of transaction I has to be strictly smaller than the timestamp of transaction J, and vice versa. So here we have an if and only if. So this means in the above example, if we assume we have again our X and there's a transaction now TJ would, let's say, write to X and would leave a timestamp here, 15. And now there's transaction I coming. Here we have the timestamp 10 and wants to read from X. And now we're comparing this 10 to 15 and we will see that, of course, 10 is strictly smaller than 15. However, this is not according to our rule here, because the timestamp of transaction I is smaller than the one here. This means that the ordering of the conflict operation should be accordingly. However, we see here that this here was executed before transaction I wanted to execute the read operation. So this would not be in line with our timestamp ordering rule. So in the example earlier, we had this variable X. And when there was TJ, let's say, writing to this X, we remember we would store in our scheduler that transaction J with timestamp 15 was writing to X. However, let's assume that this operation was not a write operation, but a read operation. So this 15 would correspond to the read of X of transaction TJ. And now there's transaction TI coming, and we had like a timestamp 10, and now also wants to read, and we know read and read is not a conflict. And in this case, of course, it doesn't really matter if there's 15 already here, because there's no problem with read and read operation on the same variable. This means that we have only problems if this was a write, and here we have a write or a read, or if this one was a read, and here we have a write operation, but read and reads are not a problem. In order to distinguish between these cases, we cannot only store one timestamp for X, but we have to store two timestamps, one that we call the read timestamp, and one we also have in addition, which we call the write timestamp. This is described on the bottom of this page. So we have, again, for every transaction, one timestamp as an identifier, and we store for every object X in our scheduler two timestamps. One we call max r scheduled, and one is called max w scheduled, corresponding to exactly what I have illustrated here, the read and the write timestamp. And not any timestamp, but these timestamps here correspond to the largest timestamps of any operation for x, any read operation for x in case of the first point here, and any write operation for this write timestamp. Let's see now what the scheduler has to do when a transaction TI wants to execute an operation P on object X. So we have transaction TI. Let's again say the timestamp was, like in the previous example, 10. This P here is a placeholder for this definition on this slide, which can be a read or a write. So let's say we have here a read operation. Then we have to now look for our object X in our scheduler, in our bookkeeping we do, for the read and the write timestamps. And we have to compare now the timestamp of TI with these timestamps here, but not with both of them, because read here has only a potential problem with write, so we have to only compare this timestamp here with this write timestamp we have like stored for our object X. If we have here a write operation, however, then we have to compare the timestamp to both the read timestamp and the write timestamp, because this write here has a potential problem with reads and writes, right? So read and read is not a problem. So let's go back to the assumption that we have here a read operation. So what does now the following say? We have to compare the timestamp TS of TI to the max Q scheduled, where Q stands for, again, a placeholder for all the operation where R has a conflict with, which is, as we know, only W. So we have to compare now the timestamp of TI with max W scheduled for our object X. And if the timestamp of transaction I is strictly smaller than what we have stored for max W scheduled here, then the operation P of transaction I is rejected. So let's say we had before a write happening to X by transaction TJ, and like in the previous example, TJ was assumed to have a timestamp 15. So here the write, so the max W schedule would be 15. And now we have to compare, because here we have a read coming in, the timestamp of TI, which we assumed was 10, to this 15. 10 is strictly smaller than 15. So this kicks in here. So we have to reject the operation P of the transaction TI. If this does not make a problem, then the transaction I can execute or can be allowed to execute PI. So this PI is forwarded to the data manager, as we have seen in the overview illustration. Then in our scheduler, we have to update the timestamps that we store for our object X here. We have to set the max P scheduled of X to the timestamp of our transaction TI if the timestamp is larger than the previously stored max P scheduled. And again, this P is a placeholder. In our case, in our example here, this would be the max R schedule, because we're talking about a read operation. In case we have here a write operation, and as we know, writes are problematic with reads and also with writes. And in this case now, we have to compare the timestamp of TI to max read scheduled and to max write scheduled. So we have to compare here our timestamp to both the read and the write timestamp that we keep for our object X. So let's see how this works in an example. We have here transaction 1, 2, and 3, and let's for simplicity assume that TS of T1 is 1, and ts of t2 is 2, and so on. So here we have the timestamp 3. And we have object x here. This is the first one, and we want to read from x. And here, let's say, is our little bookkeeping store we have in our scheduler. So we have here a place to store the max r scheduled and the max w scheduled. Initially, they are not initialized, or they are just assumed to be 0. And now we have here also our object y. And again, we have the read and the write timestamps, and they're also initialized or not initialized in the beginning. Let's just start looking at this read operation of transaction 1. We have to compare this now to the write timestamp here, because read and read is fine, and read and write is a potential problem. But again, here is nothing written there, so we just say everything is fine, and this can be granted, this operation. But now what we have to do is to update here the max r schedule timestamp, and we will set it to 1. Next command in our schedule is this one here, a write command on x by transaction 2. And now we know that write has a problem with read and write. So we have to now compare the timestamp 2 here with the information stored here and here. Well, here there's nothing stored, so we ignore it for now. But here we have a 1. And now we're comparing this timestamp 2 with the 1. And as you can see here, this situation here does not kick in, because the timestamp of transaction 2 is not strictly smaller than 1. Hence, it's not a problem. Then that means that this write operation is accepted and forwarded to the data manager. And now we have to update the write timestamp here. So we will now update this to a 2. Okay, let's go on. Next operation here, we have a read operation to object y by transaction 3. Again, initially we don't have to compare, because they are not set yet, read and write timestamps. So it's clear that we can execute, or this operation gets granted to be more precise. And now we have to update our timestamp here, the read timestamp, and we set it to 3. Now, what's happening next is here we have a write request by transaction 2 on y, and we know that read and write is a problem, and write is a problem. So we have to go for the object y in our bookkeeping, which is here, and we have to compare the timestamp 2 of transaction 2 to our information we stored here for y. Again, here's nothing stored, so there's no problem. But now we're comparing this 3 with a 2. And now you see that this condition here, the first one, kicks in. The timestamp of transaction 2, which is 2, is strictly smaller than this 3 here. And this is now a problem, and this operation gets rejected. Hence, transaction 2 is aborted. So now we have the next command would be the write operation on object set. So we have to do our bookkeeping also for set. Initially, there's nothing stored, so we can just grant this command and update now the write timestamp to 3. And now we see here, eventually, we have also a read of transaction 1 on set. And well, it's the read operation, and read is of course in conflict with the write. So we have to compare the timestamp of transaction 1, which is here a 1, to this 3 here. And 1 is strictly smaller than 3, and again this first case kicks in, and the command here is rejected. Hence, transaction 1 is also aborted. This is how timestamp ordering works. In order to summarize more formally these different situations, we have here 5 rules. We abbreviate, to keep the notation a bit shorter, the timestamp of transaction I with I, so also for the previous example. And now let's have a look at the first rule. This means that the operation we want to do is a read, and the timestamp is larger or equal than the max write timestamp of x. So we called it previously max w scheduled. Here we dropped the schedule, doesn't matter, right? It's the same meaning here, max w of x. So we see that this I is larger than this max w schedule timestamp, which is stored together with x. And this is not the first condition on the previous page. So that means that there's no problem. And we update the max read timestamp to I in case I is larger than this timestamp we had stored previously for max read. Second rule, well, let's go now first of all maybe to the fifth rule, because here we see the same situation happening. It's a read operation that transaction I plans to execute, but now we have a different situation. I is strictly smaller than this max W scheduled, in which case the first bullet point on the previous slide kicks in and we have to reject the operation, hence we call it also reset. Hence, we have to abort transaction TI. Let's now have a look at the second one here, rule 2. You see here we want to write. And since write has a problem with read and with write, so potential conflict to be more precise, we have to compare now the timestamp I of our transaction I to the max R scheduled and the max W scheduled. In case here we see that this I is larger or equal to this timestamp here, the read timestamp, and also larger or equal to the write timestamp, then everything is fine. And we are updating the max write of x, and the write command gets sent to the data manager. The other way around, so we want to write. And let's assume now we're comparing this now for this rule 4 only to the max read scheduled. And I is strictly smaller than max R of x, then the first bullet point on the previous slide kicks in, and we are resetting here transaction I because we had to reject this command. And now we can come up with an additional modification, which means here we have rule 3. Here we're comparing, first of all, we see that we want to write, obviously, right? And now we're comparing this timestamp I to the max read timestamp. And in case this is larger, first of all, let's assume it's fine, right? This is fine. And the timestamp is strictly smaller than the max write timestamp here. In principle, this would be a problem, because we have here a timestamp I, which is strictly smaller than the conflicting timestamp from before. However, in this case, in the special case that we call Thomas Wright rule, we would ignore this write operation by transaction I. So this is an optimization trick. It avoids rejecting this operation, where as a consequence we would reject or abort the entire transaction. What Thomas Wright rule is proposing is to ignore the write, because in order to have this write, not to make a trouble with a previous read, this from a different transaction, this write anyway has to be a blind write. That means a write without a read before, in which case it would be overwritten by the previous write anyway, by transaction that was setting this timestamp. This is like little optimization, reduction of write conflicts, and of course does not capture the case of having a conflict between a write and read. It's only a write-write conflict in which the latest write wins. So by a younger transaction, this one wins, and the older transaction write would get just ignored, because it would have been overwritten in any case. However, again, note this does not get rid of the problem where we have a conflict between the intended write and the previous read. It's only talking about blind writes. So the timestamp comparison for the read has to be fine, and this one is not fine. However, we will not abort, we will just ignore. This is what Thomas Wright rule proposes, and if you're ignoring Thomas Wright rule, then accordingly this third rule will be changed, such that in these cases the transaction will also be reset because we have this situation here, like for the previous slide first bullet point. There's more on concurrency control than we have captured here in the course. There are different locking models. There are also hierarchical locking and lock propagation. So you can have a read lock that you want to later on change to a write lock. There's something called multi-version concurrency control or snapshot isolation. And what we did not talk about now is optimistic concurrency control, backward-oriented or forward-oriented. There are also additional anomalies that we did not consider here, like phantom read or write skew. So you see, this was only like an introduction, which was still quite long, right? But there's of course more if you're looking at this book by Wycombe and Fossen, and you see how large that is. And this is even not complete, so there's a lot of things going on there. If you're looking at what SQL, the standard, proposes in terms of transaction management, you will find commands where you can set so-called isolation levels. So what we have discussed earlier was serial schedules and serializable schedules, which will guarantee a full isolation guarantee, like ACID demands. However, for performance reasons, there can be different lower isolation levels that you can set to have more concurrent operations without rejecting operations. So for instance, you can have isolation levels read uncommitted, and the name already tells you that this is something that you would not allow when you're talking about serializable schedules in our meaning from the previous videos. Read committed, repeatable read, and finally serializable, and some other things around like read-only transactions you can also have, which are not so then critical in terms of browsing the database, for instance. And here you can see what these different levels mean according to the SQL standard. For instance, here read uncommitted, the weakest consistency model. You don't have any logs for read operations. Then you have read committed, and you see here that the write locks are in strict two-phase locking, and the read locks are only held for a short duration. And you can still have some anomalies like non-repeatable read and phantom read. And if you're going on further on, we see here we have repeatable read. Writes and read locks are in 2PL. And still you can have anomalies like non-repeatable read and phantom read. Phantom read, non-repeatable read, we did not consider here in the course. If you want to have additional information, you might want to look it up. Then you have serializable, right? In principle, this is like full serializability that we have discussed here. This is not always the default level. And here the suggestion is how to realize this using, or we would realize it using strict 2PL for write and read locks. In addition, we would also lock indices and predicates in order to avoid non-repeatable read and phantom read. There's also something called snapshot isolation, which is implemented in Oracle and Postgres, which would have or has performance benefits compared to like a hard 2PL locking to achieve serializability. But we will not go into detail here. In case you're interested, you can read the slides and look up for more information in books or online. So now we're looking at Postgres to conclude this part on concurrency control. Postgres provides all four isolation levels. There are some buts here. Read uncommitted has the same effect as read committed. repeatable read has the same effect as serializable. And now comes the biggest but. Serializable does not mean serializable as we have discussed this here. Why? Because the what Postgres is implementing is the so-called snapshot isolation I previously mentioned, which is not the same as fully serializable for performance reasons, but there's still some more handling of to avoid anomalies, which is valid for practical purposes.